Revolution.radio. www.freedomslips.com. Check it out.
Galactic Interstellar Council on Revolution Radio Studio A, Fridays at 2 p.m. Eastern. Join us as we traverse the starseed paradigm, as expressed in the time-space continuum that we know as the divine expression of love and light. Integrating this conscious unity into the galactic paradigm. So welcome all, both terrestrial beings and galactic beings as one. So be it. You're listening to Revolution Radio.
Como va? This is Giuseppe from the District of Criminals. I pulled some strings and gotten you front row seats to my new show, The Perfect, Triangle. Live. Friday, 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern Time on Revolution Radio Studio A. The perfect triangle is equilateral, three sides of the same length. In an angry, bipolar world, three perfect sides reveal many truths.
Body, mind, and spirit.
Thought, word, and deed.
Conspiracy, propaganda, and truth.
Natural health, allopathic tyranny, and your body.
Freedom, globalism, and sovereign nations.
And so much more. Each week, the Perfect Triangle will blast through fake news lies, champion the natural way and natural law, unravel the Orwellian deceptions of our corrupt government, reveal the satanic evil of globalist banks and transnational corporations. Tune in every Friday, 6 p.m. Eastern, to Revolution Radio Studio A for thoughtful discussions with free thinkers. Your calls are always welcome. The Perfect Triangle with Giuseppe from the District of Criminals. Join me, won't you?
This is Revolution Radio. Studio B. Are you ready? Haunted spirits and stories, both current and from days gone by. It's the Spectre Detective. With Christine Hart.
Hi, Christine Hart. Welcome to the show tonight, Spectre Detectives. So I'm just going to introduce people. I have got to see to my son. Unfortunately, he's not very well. I'll be back for the second hour. So for the first hour, we have my co-host, Jana, who is going to be interviewing Ben Emlyn-Jones. And I'm sure a lot of you have heard of him and we're excited to speak to him today. So I am going to bring him on. And Jana, if I can, as you know, it's always very hard when I'm trying to be techie and I'm not really a hugely techie person. Okay, so I think I found him.
Hello.
Oh, hi, Ben. How are you?
Hello, Christine. Not bad.
Good.
Nice to talk to you again.
Yes, thank you. It's really nice. I'm sorry I can't stay. I will be listening. I will be listening, but I've got to drive my son somewhere. So Jana is going to interview you, and I'm going to be listening on the headphones. So, in the car, it'll be on the radio. So I'll be able to hear.
Okay, no problem.
So that'll be exciting.
Problem. Yeah. We actually spoke about a year ago because you appeared. It was the basis project in Devizes, but you were on Skype.
Yeah, you interviewed me, didn't you? That's
right.
Really
yes.
Good. Is that still up on YouTube?
It should be, yes. It should be on Miles' channel.
Yeah, he put a load of my shows up, but he's a bit funny with me, a bit moody. I don't know what's the matter with him. He seems to think I've done something to him. He acts like I've murdered his mother or something.
He may feel better another day. I mean, it depends when you approach him. You know, he's all right.
I know.
He just has moods sometimes, you know. But,
yeah.
he's all right.
Yeah. Hope so. So let me bring Jana on, and I'll leave you two guys to it, yeah?
Right, you are. Thanks very much.
I'll see you later, and I look forward to hearing this, Ben.
Thanks, Christine. Okay. See you later.
Hi, good evening.
Hello, Jana.
Oh, hi, Ben.
How you doing?
I'm fine.
Oh, good.
So, we missed the introduction music.
Oh, have we? Oh, no worries. But,
I think we have.
But thanks for having me on the show. It's good to be on your programme.
You are very welcome. I've really been looking forward to this. So I'll just say good evening, listeners, wherever you may be. It's lovely to have your company tonight. So our guest tonight on the Christine Joanna Hart Show, Spectre Detectives, with Christine Joanna Hart and myself, Jana Greasley, is the infamous... some may say famous, Ben Emlyn-Jones, who is a veteran of the British UFO scene, is a published author and also a renowned investigator. He has many an interesting tale to tell about big doings that go on in Britain and has lots of things to say. So, Ben, could you give us a bit of a background about yourself and your history?
Certainly. Well, I am both famous and infamous, depending on who you talk to, because it kind of depends. But yeah, I am Ben. My name is Ben Emlyn-Jones, and I am the author of the Herpanwo blog. Herpanwo is H-P-A-N-W-O, which stands for Hospital Porters Against the New World Order. I used to be a hospital porter, actually. I was one for 23 years. I'm now sort of in retirement, but only sort of partly. But what's happened is I'm a kind of chap. I've never been a journalist. I've never worked for any publication, but I am somebody who over the course of my life has come to realize that many of the subjects that most people consider fringe or off the wall or even disreputable, such as the paranormal, government cover-ups, UFOs, things like that, they are real. And they're not only real, they're actually the most important subjects affecting planet Earth and its inhabitants today. And so taking these things seriously, I think, has become a necessity for us as a human species and for our planet and the universe at large.
100% in agreement with you there, Ben. Could you describe to us your UFO career?
Yeah, I'm somebody who's always had a basic interest in UFOs. I mean, even when I was a child, I used to like TV shows about them. But it's something that came... It's something that grew up gradually with me. I gradually became more and more interested in the subject. I started reading books about them. I started attending conferences as well. And funnily enough, this wasn't inspired by any sighting. Most people get interested in the subject after they've had an experience themselves. I didn't. I have actually seen things in the sky I can't explain on about a dozen occasions. I'd say maybe three or four of these incidents really defy explanation, I would say. What I've done is since then I have started writing articles on the subject, making YouTube videos. I have my own radio show called Herpanwo Radio where I discuss the matter. And eventually I ended up writing three books on the subject. These are called Roswell Revealed and Roswell Redeemed. And they're fictional books, they're just stories. But what led to them was the fact that there is actually – a cover-up of the UFO phenomenon by the government. It's what the ex-politician Stephen Bassett calls the truth embargo. Literally, the government know about it. They have decisive evidence, and they're keeping it from us. The purpose of the books, the purpose of writing these stories, was to explore the possibility that we actually gained the truth about these subjects instead of the lies and what would happen. So that's where that led me to. That's this whole idea has consumed me. I mean, I'm fascinated by it. I've dedicated my life to it.
Yes, well, that's why we've got you on the show, because I would say you're one of the longest running, most prominent UFO investigators in Britain, quite a popular figure.
Oh, thank you.
Quite well known. a kind of requirement at all the when we're in normal operating mode at all the UFO conferences and the Truther events in Britain.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I mean, I've really missed the conference scene, actually. I was just saying, talking to Christine about the conference in November last year at Devizes. That's the Basis Project conference. I went there. I was actually the MC of the event, and I was one of the speakers as well. It was absolutely wonderful. And Christine was there as well on Skype, and it was really, really great. And since then, there's only been one conference, and that was one in Hull. And since then, because of the coronavirus lockdown, the entire circuit has gone off the air. It's disappeared. And yeah. I miss that. I really do. I feel isolated with not being able to go to these conferences and meet people and talk to people. Because, there's not many people. I live in Oxford, and it's a bit of a conformist place. Although I have set up a local group called Dreaming Sources. I've had moderate interest in it.
Yes, I was going to ask you about that. You'd set up a local group. What's the response been like?
It's been pretty good. I mean, because of the COVID lockdown, we haven't had a chance to have a formal meeting, but I have. They are people in the local area who I know about and I've met. There's a lady who runs a health food shop. She's involved. There's a couple who live just outside Oxford who are keen, and there's a couple of other individuals who have also expressed an interest. And Mark Devlin is also involved, although he's actually moved. He doesn't live near Oxford anymore, but he used to. But Mark Devlin, who does the who writes about music and things like that, he has his music.
Oh yes, yeah. I've heard a lot of his work. He's quite an interesting person as well. He's got some interesting things to say.
Oh yeah.
So would you say that the people that have joined your group, they've all had experiences?
Some of them have, yeah. Others just have an interest in the particular subject. Some came along to the conference I organised in Oxford in 2018. I actually organised a conference called Dreaming Sources. Some came to that. Others, a lot of them I don't know really well enough to ask. I should actually, when I get to know them better, I'll be able to ask them. But I have actually met up with a few other people because there's a local coronavirus group there who are protesting against the lockdown in Oxford.
Rebels are growing.
So we're not alone here. You know, there are people. There are definitely people who are, I think outside the box, unlike most people in this city, because Oxford, of course, is the primary training center, really, for the Illuminati elite, because we've got the university here where all the greats and all the movers and shakers come to learn their trade.
Oh, do tell us more. I thought Cambridge is where the spies were and the black magicians.
Oh, well, both. And, of course, Alistair Crowley was at Cambridge, at Trinity College, as were Anthony Blunt and Guy Burgess and the others. Was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And Kim Philby and Donald MacLean, who were indeed spies, yes. But Oxford has had its – Oxford is like another part of that network. And Oxford has produced plenty – I'm sure it's produced plenty of spies, but it's also produced many of the world's leaders and so-called – I mean, the people the Illuminati basically put in place to control things, people like Bill Clinton, U.S. president. Margaret Thatcher, prime minister. Tony Blair, prime minister. Harold Wilson, prime minister. Bob Hawke, Australian prime minister. Several other people from places like Australia, South Africa, and other areas, especially in the Commonwealth. A lot of them. There's Cecil Rhodes. Is the guy behind it? Yeah, he's the big one. He believed in a one world government. He set up. He gave all his considerable money because he's very rich. When he died in 1901, he created something called the Rhodes Scholarship. So all his money is now used to train people he thinks is considered to have the right stuff to achieve his vision of world government, and it's administered here in Oxford. So.
Well, never stops, does it? forgive me if I'm wrong. Isn't Oxford where the Bungden Club? Used to do its thing.
It still does.
Shall we describe it for the American listeners?
It's not a secret society. It's a dining club, really, for elite students. And it's been running since the 1880s, so quite a long time, 140 years or so. And basically, a lot of elite students at various colleges, I think especially Balliol College, they get together in this club, and they go out every so often. They go out for a meal, a very posh meal at the Randolph Hotel, which is like our grand posh hotel here in Oxford. And the rule is that the poorest student has to pay for everything, and that's the kind of rule. I don't know where they come up with that one, but I mean, I say poor relatively because they're all very rich, you know. So they can And then they tend to get drunk and exhibit a lot of antisocial behaviour, which has become a bit notorious in the city. For example, they often smash things up and things like that. And
they smash the restaurant up, don't they? And then they pay for it.
Yeah, they often cause a lot of vandalism. They also do humiliating things. They once they took out a £20 note in front of a homeless person once and just burnt it in front of him, which is, I think, was very cruel, extremely cruel. And they killed a tortoise. There's this old tortoise called Rosa Luxemburg. There's a tortoise that lived in a Balliol College, used to live at Balliol College, but 150-year-old tortoise called Rosa Luxemburg, and she disappeared. And no one knows exactly what happened to her, but it's suspected that the Bullingdon Club took her and probably killed her.
They killed a tortoise called Rosa Luxemburg and killed her.
That's what we believe, yeah. They actually kidnapped this tortoise and killed her. It's not been proven. But members of the Bullingdon Club, it's very interesting. There's firstly David Dimbleby, the TV presenter.
Yes.
And two prime ministers, former David Cameron, and our present one, our present fearless leader, Boris Badenoff himself.
Oh, Joe.
Yeah, he was in it as well. it's typical of Oxford. You look around, see who all the students are. You know, you'll be seeing them, you know, in press conferences in government someday. You know, Oxford is the place where they train these people, the people who serve the Illuminati elite, who control the world. And they bring them to Oxford, they train them up.
And of course, the Oxford Union debates are very famous, aren't they, for bringing all kinds of figures from Katie Price, who was a Page 3 topless model in Britain. She was famous for that, to a debate. And Tommy Robinson, the ex-leader of the English Defence League. He was at a debate. But I believe, haven't they gone very woke now? And they're banning certain people and there's all kinds of shenanigans going on.
Oh, like everything else, it has become very affected by wokeism. I mean, when Tommy Robinson spoke, there were huge protests outside. It really was. And very often in the street nearby, there's often massive protests because someone's speaking there they don't like. I mean, they do. I mean, you can't let people you disagree with speak.
I wonder if was there a big demo on Katie Price? Was it Stop the Boobs or something? Protest against boobs. No big knock.
No big knockers here. Oh, my. I don't think she's a terribly controversial character. One person they did have was David Icke. He spoke there. Now there's a video of it now. He probably wouldn't be able to get in there now because, there would be massive protests outside because unfortunately, I mean, they do have a policy of free speech. I mean, this is their plan. Anyone's supposed to be able to say what they want.
And
if they're talking nonsense, then they can be...
it'll be the lizards. They won't let him in because of the lizards. It's funny, though, isn't it, how the lizard people, they've gone full mainstream now. I was listening to the radio, I think it was yesterday morning, just getting up and talk radio, I listen to that a lot. And I heard the presenter reading out a comment and somebody had said something like, and anybody who believes that lizards run the world needs sectioning. And I thought, yes, David, you have arrived. Even the ordinary plebeian in the streets is talking about your Draco theory.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? I mean, things are becoming mainstream now. And David's like hit the headlines. He wrote the book The Biggest Secret, where he said that lizards run the world. And what he actually meant was that people have had this experience where they see people, very often it's people in power, who appear to take on a reptilian shape when they look at them. Now, these are often psychically sensitive people. Now, it sounds bizarre, and David says, I'm the first to admit this sounds crazy, but people kept reporting this to me. And indeed, I have spoken to people who've had this experience. I've not had it myself. I've never seen anyone shapeshift into some kind of lizard. But, you know, I met a woman once, actually, and she wrote a book, I can't remember the author, she wrote a book under the name Susan Reed, That's not her real name. Her real name's Jenny something. And she was sitting there talking, perfectly normal. And she said to me, "Oh, yeah, I was married to a reptilian shapeshifter. My husband was a reptilian shapeshifter." And I thought, what? I looked at her, a completely normal-looking woman. I mean, I've been talking to her for about an hour before that, and she seemed perfectly normal. She was at the probe conference at the St. Anne's, and she told me about her experiences, and I actually got hold of her book, which I can't remember what it's called, actually. I can look it up for you later. But it's extraordinary. It's an extraordinary tale, and it's one I've heard from other people as well. Now, if any people need... Anyone who says, well, it's so crazy that anyone who suggests it should be sectioned is, I think, anti-intellectual. Because simply saying, well, that sounds too crazy to be true, therefore it must be too crazy to be true, is what people used to say when a person came up with the idea of building an aeroplane.
Yeah.
Or building a space rocket or something like that. They said, well, it's,
I agree. It
they actually said this can't be
you
done.
You can't limit human experience just because you think that something shouldn't exist because it's not within your paradigm. That's
exactly.
Ridiculous.
That's
well, it's strange, right? We had Deborah Hatswell on the show last week.
Ah, Deborah, I know.
Yeah, and she was talking about a lass in Preston who saw a reptilian in a bloody car park in Preston.
Yeah.
I mean, the bookers are everywhere. What are they doing in bloody Preston?
Apparently, they can be found. Britain apparently is the centre for all this. Believe it or not, we're living in the country which is like central to this entire global agenda. It's someone, I don't know why someone said it was the heart chakra of the world, which is
ridiculous.
I mean, I don't know that specifically, but this is the area where you get the most crop circles. It's also the country which has the biggest tradition of like prehistoric monuments, Stonehenge, Avery, etc.
We were saying that last week. We were saying about. Where you get everything going off, like places in Yorkshire, like Rendlesham, places like that that you know very well, there's always a lot of ancient sites, there's always a lot of ley lines, it's the same story every time.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, if you're looking for weird stuff, whether it's the Bigfoot that Deborah talks about, or reptilians, or UFOs, or ghosts, or anything like that, I mean, Britain is the place to go. If you're not in Britain, it's the place to go, because that's where it all happens. Obviously, these things happen across the world, but it's concentrated on these little islands here off the north coast of Europe for some reason. So it's really quite remarkable. And, I mean, it's the good news is, though, Jana, it's not as... it's something that's becoming more fashionable. I mean, people talk about lizards. They may laugh at it, but at least they're talking about it. And now, among our number now, we have the President of the United States. He's one of us now. Donald Trump is a loony like us. Hooray!
Oh, God, don't even go there, Ben. Don't even go there. Anyway, staying on the UFOs and aliens angle, right, what would you say is the biggest thing that's happened in Britain UFO-wise? What's the biggest event in your opinion?
The biggest, definitely the Rendlesham Forest UFO incident of 1980. That is by far, the most significant UFO event in the world, because it was so well documented, because there were so many witnesses. It was reported on very quickly thanks to Jenny Randalls and Dot Street and Brenda Butler and a few other people, Larry Warren and people like that. It's just thanks to them and Georgina Bruni as well. Because it was investigated so soon afterwards and the evidence came out so quickly, that makes it very significant.
And the newspapers reported on it as well, didn't they?
Yep, 1980. Oh, just 3 years later, 1983, there was a report based on the Holt memo. This was Lieutenant Colonel Charles Holt, who was the deputy base commander. He actually wrote a report which was declassified. Which were all leaked, which it depends how you look at it, because there's several different ideas about how it got out into the media. But if you compare that to the Roswell incident, for example, absolutely nothing was said at all for 31 years. And that's when suddenly one of the witnesses approached a ufologist and told him about it, and that's when the investigation began. And by that time, so much time had passed that some of the witnesses were dead, the others couldn't remember very well, others had been told to keep quiet.
They were warned off. They were told they were going to be killed or put in camps or something, weren't they? My God, it's amazing. Well, what about the Berwyn Mountain crash? Because I would have thought that was a bit like our Roswell.
It's been described as the Welsh Roswell. It's a remarkable event that happened in northeast Wales in 1974. It was a huge... explosion, what's been described as an earthquake. And that's how it was reported in the news, just an earthquake that suddenly struck. But what's happened since is some of the witnesses have reported seeing a large circular glowing object up on the top of what's called the Barwen Mountains, which is a mountain range. And there's all kinds of other things that got involved. A lot of other investigators started looking into it, such as Scott Felton. And I think it's a very significant event, which it appears some odd object did appear there.
Yeah.
It came down from the sky, and then it was seen to rise up into the sky.
Ah.
And, it's a very weird thing indeed. And it appears that there's some knowledge of that within the government, which they're not talking about. So, something similar actually happened in South Wales much more recently in
20... Really?
Yeah, it's a place called Penterch in South Wales, which is remarkably similar. It was a triangular-shaped object, not a round one, but it's still remarkably similar.
So isn't that one of ours, a TR-3B, if it's triangle?
It's hard to know what it is or where it comes from. I mean, there's – because – If you look at the secret space program, you mentioned the TR-3B. This is said to be a triangular-shaped craft with an anti-gravity propulsion system and power plant. So it's an aircraft, yeah, literally, that doesn't have wings. It just levitates because it can control gravity. Now, if that craft exists, and I believe it does, it's possible that some of the sightings of strange objects in the sky, which have been explained as extraterrestrial, basically aliens coming to visit us, could actually be man-made. They might be made by people within the secret space program. Of course, this doesn't explain every sighting. The incident at Penterch, I do question, because it was obviously something that was ostentatiously trying to show itself. It lit lights up and things like that. It seemed to just appear out of nowhere, and it as if it materialized, and then it.
My guess is it's
not human. It's not human, my guess.
I don't know, but triangles, we get them over Cumbria. So there's something going on there. So my next question is, what do you think is the current state of British ufology then? Just pretend COVID isn't happening, put all that aside. How do you view things? How do you think, what is the state of things at the moment?
Well, it's tricky to pretend that COVID's not happening because it's just so ingrained into our lives now, but I'll have a go. Things are actually, in some ways, we've made a lot of progress. There's been a lot of investigation, a lot of new stuff has come out. There's been several new magazines have come out, UFO Truth Magazine, etc. There's lots of new documentaries. I mean, this is across the world, not just Britain, this is across the world, but... there seems to be almost every couple of months a new UFO documentary comes out. So there's obviously a market for these sorts of things. At the same time, there's a lot of division. There's a lot of personal conflict within ufology, which is hampering efforts in many, many ways, which is a shame. It's a great shame.
Okay. So are you talking about Britain now or across ufology, across the board?
Oh, you find it's pretty much everywhere, although there's several British, there's several things in Britain I could talk about, but it seems to be, I mean, I have had personal experience with this. I've been sucked into this myself, and it's very sad. It's very sad. What happens is that somebody doesn't like someone else. It's a clash of personalities, or something goes wrong in their friendship. And it's just, rather than keeping it personal between themselves, they tend to publicize it. Maybe this is something to do with the internet, I don't know, but they tend to publicize it and try to create some kind of movement out of this personal dislike. Very often it involves telling lies about the person they don't like, accusing them of making up their stories if they're a witness, accusing them of being a government agent if they're a researcher or activist. And there's numerous examples of this, and it's sad. It's childish. It's very childish. And it's very.
Yeah. It's almost like, I wonder if they're a disruptor.
I do wonder if, like I said, if they're accusing other people of being agents, maybe they doth protest too much. I do wonder.
It's just that I've been involved in political movements for a long time now, ever since I was a teenager, in various different forms, from feminism to CND to the Green Movement. And I've noticed that, particularly within CND, in the 80s, there was, now I know this was the security services, it's got security services written all over it, but there was somebody got raped at one of the camps, one of the peace camps, and that set everything off big time, because obviously there was a big feminist element within British. CND was the campaign for nuclear disarmament. It's pretty much faded into nothingness now, but in the 80s, it was raging because we'd started the Trident program, the Trident missile program, Trident submarines. So, yeah, there's things like that. But, I mean, we know about the spy cops now, don't we, about the cops that infiltrate people's lives and they're there for years and they even have relationships and have babies with people, which I just find beyond comprehension, to be quite honest. But I do know that, speaking for myself, I was involved with some anti-Sellafield stuff and it turned out the person that was leading it, she was being spied on by the French Secret Service for quite a while.
Yeah, I mean, the infiltration of the anti-nuclear campaign did happen. It happened in the States as well. And, yeah, the funny enough, David Shaler, you may have heard of, he's a former MI5 officer.
Friends with him on Facebook, yeah.
Yeah, he's an amazing chap. He's an interesting chap. I mean, he actually talked openly because he didn't believe it at first before he joined the service, but he'd heard how the Greenham Common camp, which was protesting against the nuclear-armed cruise missiles.
That was there.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, there's so many they could form a chain all the way around. They could link arms and can surround the base.
I was there that day. Embrace the Base, it was called.
Oh, right.
It was amazing. There was enough women that we all linked arms and we surrounded it.
That's quite something. That's quite a lot of people, yeah. Because
it was. It was fantastic. It was great being part of it. It was. I only stayed there one night. But, I mean, Greenham's complicated because there's such a strong feminist element, and then within feminism you start going off into a whole load of like different divisions. But anyway, sorry, Ben, I interrupted
it. It's all right. No, it's okay. But David was saying that he said that I didn't believe it. So they thought people were being paranoid when they said that MI5 was actually putting its agents into this movement, like recruiting people to join this peace camp, to go and live at the peace camp, pretend to be part of them, and then report back to the government on what they were doing. But he said when he joined the service, he found out it was completely true. There were a large number. And so it does happen. There's no doubt that it happens. And indeed, there have been proven examples within ufology. The disreputable case of Paul Benowitz is a good example of that, because Paul Benowitz was not an agent, but he was a man who was very interested in UFOs. This is way back in the early 80s. And he made friends with a guy called Richard Doty. And Richard Doty, it turns out, was part of this basically spy ring called the Avery Network, it was called. And they used him. They used him to... They got him to look in the things that weren't real and make up stories, and they persuaded him that he was seeing things that wasn't.
Oh, right.
Yeah. William Moore, unfortunately, William Moore, the guy who co-wrote the first Roswell book, he was involved as well. I think he regretted it later on. In fact, he confessed and said he wished he'd never done it. But
very strange, isn't it?
It does happen. Yeah, it does happen. So
talk about all this for ages, that side of it. So moving on from UFOs, just like generally like the truth of movement, how do you feel that's going?
Well, it's the coronavirus pandemic has actually had an effect on this. Firstly, it has hampered our efforts at meeting and organising, although we have to do it online, but we can't get together at conferences, which has caused an element of isolation. At the same time, it's given us an issue to campaign about. I mean, the truth of a movement now is actually, it's in a sense, it's exposed a lot of what the government are up to, because the coronavirus lockdown is without a doubt engineered. I mean, the virus, whether it exists or not, there's no doubt that it's being used. It's being taken advantage of.
It's Operation Lockstep, isn't it?
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's been taken advantage of by the authorities to stretch their Orwellian muscles and create more and more governmental control, more and more regulation, more and more control of our lives, more and more intrusion into our lives, to the point where we lose our privacy, we lose our freedom of movement, we lose our freedom of association. So, yeah, this is like whatever the origins of this pandemic, whether it's artificial or natural, it's being used opportunistically by the government for that purpose. And the truth movement, a lot of them have done a magnificent job, I would say. People, especially like, for example, David Icke and Mark Devlin, who I talked about earlier, they in particular have really done a good job getting this out. I pay tribute as well to the Oxford activists, who the group in Oxford, which has been doing a fantastic work as well.
Well, did you see the big demo today in Manchester?
I saw photos of it. Yeah, it's brilliant.
Big demo. Red Pill Phil on YouTube has got some excellent footage. And I noticed there was some graffiti on a wall in Piccadilly Gardens, and it said, "The Northwest will not be a petri dish."
Right, yeah.
And I thought, right on, brothers and sisters.
Absolutely, yeah. And you know
it
what?
It was very big.
Because in Liverpool, they've got the army in Liverpool right now.
Yeah.
And they're to help with organising tests and testing. They're doing mass testing of people. And they set up very expensive centres, which are almost empty. And there are security guards there that don't like people looking in. Apparently, Serco is involved in this as well, which is a very sinister company. Yeah, you know, you've heard of them before, haven't you?
Oh, yeah.
They're an enormous company, massive company. And they're very primarily government contractors.
Yeah, well, it's them and MERS, isn't it, that have got the contracts for all the hotels and migrant bases.
Yeah.
Military bases for the migrants, migrant bases. Yeah, there was a lady from Liverpool who was talking today at the demo in Piccadilly Gardens, but the army were there in lockdown one. They were offering testing in car parks, but there was nobody there. But I noticed during lockdown one, they were putting up 5G towers around Merseyside. Because there's a few people filmed that and put it on YouTube. And it was when it was the real lockdown and hardly anybody could go out. And they were going up to this guy saying, what, I can't do the accent, but what are you doing, mate? And they said, oh, yeah, putting up the towers, you know. So they took advantage of lockdown to put the 5G towers up. So the army were already there doing a bit of testing, but it didn't look like anybody was going. So maybe that was a bit of a practice run or something. But yeah, this lady was saying in Liverpool, from Liverpool, was that the general feeling is they are the test for how things are going to go. And it's interesting because you know about Liverpool's reputation, don't you?
Well, it's got a reputation for a few things, but what in particular?
Well, it's very sort of like northerners who won't take any shit off anybody.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah,
don't mess with the Scouse grit, you know.
Yeah, they've got a very, very strong sense of identity, and it's a very working class town, city.
Yeah.
Long tradition, so big culture. So, in other words, it does look sinister in the sense that Liverpool is being done first because it's like if they can break the Scousers down, then they can break anybody down almost.
I think they're testing it on the toughest people in the country first, you know, to see how they go.
I think we might have a breakthrough. I think Liverpool and Manchester might unite over this, which would be incredible. It would be like an Israeli-Palestinian peace deal if Liverpool and Manc, because you know, like if you're in prison and stuff, you know, and you're from somebody's in Liverpool, somebody's in Manchester, there's trouble.
They've got to put them in separate wings and stuff, don't they?
Oh, yeah, it's a big, big deal. So,
certainly it's with the football, isn't it? Yeah,
the fact they might be uniting is massive.
Well, you never, nothing like having a common enemy to put your personal differences aside, and he did, didn't he? And it's that's on a sort of global scale, but on a local scale too. I think people realise that this is nothing is not what it appears to be. A lot of people I know are very supportive of the protest. I went along to a brilliant demonstration in Oxford City Centre a couple of weeks ago, and it was like loads of people. We got a bit. We only four people hurled abuse at us for Oxford. That's pretty good, I think, considering it's so close. We had lots of people coming up talking to us, really, very, very encouraging. And we had a really, really great afternoon. It was really great fun. Wonderful weather, and everyone was really nice, and we had a great time. And I met some of the people that later, you know, are part of the local group as well. So I think as long as people keep like talking about this and keep doing things and spreading the word and refusing to comply and refusing to be afraid and sit around behind their face mask and just stand in line and all these things and just be one of these slaves who just will let the government do what they want with them. Just save me from the coronavirus and things like that. You'll find that the government's tricks won't work. People will be able to see through them, and they'll be it'll be stopped. So that's what I hope for. That's where we're heading. I think things are looking up, you know.
Well, that brings me nicely on to my next question is, where do you see the future for Britain and the subjects we're interested in, you know, generally speaking? Because a lot of the things we're interested in are all about exposing truth and exposing how people have experiences of things that are anomalous or unusual, or even experience, like I mentioned before when I was messaging you, Andrew Gine. You know who Andrew Gine is, don't you?
Is this someone from, is this the lady from Texas you're talking to?
No, Andrew Gine is actually a Scouser, going back to Liverpool.
Sorry.
An ex-copper. No, it's fine. Andrew Gine is intersex. So she's actually Terry, but she has both bits, in other words.
Okay.
But she, if you'll have to check her YouTube channel out. But there's a lot of interesting aspects to Andrew Gine, but one of them is that she is a whistleblower, and what she's whistleblowed about in the Merseyside police. And interestingly, Darren G, who is a notorious gangster, I would say, is no other way of putting it, in Liverpool, has confirmed what she said. Is they've just been involved in covering up paedophilia for decades.
Yeah.
And I think... So the point I'm getting to is there's a lot of uncovering, lifting of the veil. There's a lot of people speaking out now about things that were previously hidden. And I think the combination, the alchemy of it all, what's the temperance card of the tarot, it's bringing it all together and it's like morphing into something, because people are fed up with mainstream politics.
Yeah.
They're just fed up with all the previous institutions. It's just the trust, the people, the police are losing trust, aren't they, day by day?
Oh, definitely.
The courts, everything. So how do you know, a person of your experience, you've talked to a lot of people, interviewed lots of people, met lots of people. Where do you see things going then?
Well, I think things are encouraging. We're making slow but steady progress. What's going to happen is we're going to find out that when we find out the truth, we might not like it. And if I think the sign of that is already happening, because the truth is actually, in many ways, it's truly horrible. And it's probably even worse than we can imagine, especially, I'm talking about especially the children, what's been happening to children, is it's got to come out because it can't go on. It's so horrible. It's when we know about it, it stops. That's when we put a stop to it. But it's all been... I mean, it comes in so many areas. For example, Christine has uncovered what's happened in Ireland with children, and other researchers have uncovered what's happened in other communities and within various institutions such as children's homes, churches, mosques, other institutions where children are, boarding schools, for example, indeed secret, and also secret military facilities where children are basically kept as test subject for various experiments and things like that. When the truth comes out about this, the magnitude and depravity of it all is going to horrify people. You're going to see people weeping in the streets everywhere. But it has to happen, Janet.
People knew about Jeffrey Epstein for ages. I knew about Jeffrey Epstein for years. I'm just a woman in England. I'm not anybody in Palm, but I knew about him. But it just goes to show the power structures that exist that kept people quiet. I mean, you've only got to look at things like the Clinton death list to know that if you talk or if you reveal, then there's a very good chance you'll end up dead, or if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time, or something will happen to your family. So people have had that hanging over them. I agree with you. I don't think people have any idea what the reality of things is and has been.
I was just going to say that Epstein, of course, a lot of people heard rumours about him going back for years, and no one took it seriously. Now people used to call those people conspiracy theorists, like yourself, who'd heard about Epstein years ago. they used to call them conspiracy theorists, but it's been proven true. Epstein now is dead. He apparently killed himself, which I don't believe a word of.
Of course he didn't.
No, his accomplice, Ghislaine Maxwell, I wonder what's going to happen to her. I mean, she's supposed to be going to trial, hopefully sometime next year. But if she does, she's hopefully that might be the domino which starts the avalanche, or the snowflake that starts the avalanche, to use the correct analogy. Because, she will hopefully name, she'll name names. This is why they killed Epstein. They couldn't let him go to trial because he knows too much. Too much will come out about other people. And we know the people who've been on the Lolita Express, the people like they've done interviews, Prince Andrew, Bill Clinton, etc. These people have serious questions to answer. They should be suspects, and they will become suspects. And Virginia Roberts Jeffrey will come out. She'll be testifying probably. But I think what happened with Maxwell is she will. I don't think they'll kill her. I don't think it'll be a suicide, but it'll be maybe she'll catch COVID-19. I don't know.
She must have done a deal to be alive this long.
Possibly. I hope she has, for what she's done, she needs to pay a very heavy price. And I mean, give all the big names on a plate, I would say. Because when that happens, no one's going to deny it anymore. All the people who said they were conspiracy theorists will not be able to deny it anymore. And that will hopefully open up the door to the truth about Ted Heath, about Jimmy Savile, about all these people.
Yeah, this is why you need to check out Andrew Guyne, because Andrew Guyne said about that guy, Nick, is it? That was exposed as being telling lies. The big guy with the dark hair, and he turned out he was actually a paedophile. According to Andrew Guyne, everybody at the Metropolitan Police knew that he was lying. And the one that said that he was abused by Ted Heath, I think, and they knew it and they went along with it. And the reason why it happened and the reason why Boris Johnson wasn't that bad for saying things have been spaffed up the wall, the money spent on investigations, is to put people off, to put victims off coming forward.
Yeah.
Because if you think you've already been through horrendous experiences and you think there's a chance that if you come forward, then you might end up just going to prison, then, and you know, it doesn't surprise me at all, but it's just incredible how these power structures can have a hold on what happens to people. You know, it's deeply evil.
Yeah.
I mean, Darren G said what happened to him was there was problems with his family. It was a police liaison, family liaison, started working with them. And then this was when he was about 15. And then next thing he said, this really posh guy turned up who was waving £50 notes at them. And he said that he'd never even seen a £50 note. And then he got taken to a bit, it's the usual story, got taken to a big country house and he woke up. The next thing he was unconscious and he woke up and he was being assaulted by several men in this house. He actually had his arm broken. They were identified by the police, weren't they?
Yeah.
The police were the finders.
They cover it up. You see, they did the same with Cyril Smith. They knew they had proof of what he was doing.
God, I've met him. I've shaken his hand at my graduation. I know.
But they knew what he was doing, and they had proof. Yeah. And they didn't say anything. And you see, Jimmy Savile. I mean, the stories about Jimmy Savile go back a long way. I mean, do you remember Johnny Rotten was like in tears because they played him that outtake from the whistle test in 1978, when it all came out, they played it to him and said, look, you knew all about this. And he was crying because I think it was shame because people, unfortunately, there was like there's a feeling in an institution when one person does something, you just go along with it and you're relieved of all responsibility because you're part of that organization. And so in a sense, you people don't feel that personal accountability.
Well,
I was going to say, even Esther Ranson. I mean, what she said shocked me. Because
what did she say?
Well, she's the founder of Childline. You think she said, oh, we all heard things about Jimmy Savile, you know, and we just sort of like thought, oh, yeah. And I thought, what? Didn't you tell anyone? Didn't you tell the bosses? Didn't you? The fact of the matter is, Jimmy Savile was at the BBC for 46 years.
Yeah.
And he was up to his dirty tricks from day one.
Yeah.
And a lot of people knew about it. A lot of people were like reporting on it. I remember David Icke put a thing on his website when Jimmy Savile died saying, you know, it was basically, well, thank God he's gone, the horrible, dirty child abuser. Of course, by then, no one actually said anything about it because David Icke was just this loony who no one would listen to. And then what do you know? It all comes out a few years later that Jimmy Savile was actually a serial child abuser and loads of worse. Yeah.
I mean, unbelievable.
What's horrible?
Well, isn't that why Jill Dando was offed?
This is a possibility. I mean, there's several different stories about Jill Dando, but the Rich Planet TV Kill Jill suggests that there was some connection with this, that she was a liability because she was going to speak out. It's honestly, if it was any other organisation, the BBC would just be shut down and the police would go in and they'd just tear the place apart and they'd interview everyone. But because it's the BBC, they just get away. They just let it carry on. They carry on with this ridiculous facade that it has this squeaky clean family image. And there's institutional collaboration. Jimmy Savile, he couldn't have got away with what he was doing for all that time without institutional collaboration. They're just now going, oh, my God, we had no idea. As if, what?
But just like the police on Merseyside, just like the police up and down the country that have covered up for the grooming gangs for 40 years. Mm. I mean, it just goes on and on and on.
NHS as well. Especially in the NHS, they were doing exactly the same. Because Jimmy Savile was volunteered as a this is very sad for me to say this, but he volunteered as a hospital porter at St. James's in Leeds. And apparently he was not only fiddling with the kids that on the children's ward, but apparently he seemed to have some kind of fetish for dead bodies in the mortuary.
Yeah, so we've heard. You can't even begin to think.
Another weird thing, do you know, one of his good friends was a guy called Peter Sutcliffe, who's, the Yorkshire
Thomas
Ripper.
Thomas Sheridan talks about that.
He's right.
He thinks he was in on it.
Well, it's just odd. It's an odd choice of friends, isn't it? He happens to be friends with a guy who turned out to be a serial killer.
The Yorkshire Ripper.
Yeah.
Yeah, what a coincidence.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I think he must have known. I wouldn't be surprised if he knew. If he knew, he wouldn't say anything. Let's put it that way, at best.
He wouldn't
say anything. Mm. Horrible man. I'm glad he's gone.
Yeah,
they burn in hell.
Just beyond belief, isn't it? It's like something from the Victorian era, like a catalogue of horrors. But I mean, at least the truth's coming out now. But like you say, I think a lot more is due to come out. We're going to be coming up to the top of the hour and the end of the interview soonish. So can you just say how people can get hold of you, what your shows are?
Yeah,
all the general info about Ben Emlyn-Jones.
That's it. If you want to know more about me, just look for Hapanwo, HPANWO, Hospital Porters Against the New World Order, and you'll find my website and my YouTube channel, radio shows, where I cover all kinds of subjects, including the ones that Jana and I have talked about this evening and many, many others. I'm a bit of a jack of all trades. I don't really specialise in any one area. I think they're all important. They're all connected.
Yeah. I really like your show on a Thursday night because it's very eclectic and I like the music that you play, but I also like your choice of guests. I mean, that guy under his house, there was some kind of weird drug factory, and it was being run by Thai people. Have I got that right?
Alan Tate, yeah.
Yes.
I mean, it's all a bit of a mystery. We don't know exactly what's going on there, but Alan has, this is in Ammanford in South Wales. He's found in his basement strange noises coming from some kind of underground facility near his house. He believes it's beneath his next door. Now, it could be the cellar of the house next door. It may be something that's not connected to the house next door. Well, there is actually a manicurist there. It was run by a Vietnamese woman who was prosecuted for human trafficking, who's actually in the newspaper because she was convicted of human trafficking. Now, the noises coming out of that cellar is quite horrible. It sounds like there's machinery running. There's also, you hear voices, including children and people crying.
I've heard it.
Yeah.
What the hell?
It's horrific.
The police haven't really investigated properly, though, have they?
Alan called the police and he tried to get them involved, especially because he was forced to leave his home because of chemicals that kept coming out of the drain, which led to poison gas filling his house. But the police just fobbed them off. You see this repeated over and over again that they'll.
Oh, that's bizarre.
Yeah.
I mean, that suggests drug manufacture and probably class A's.
It could well be, yeah. I mean, it's something that Alan is now basically going around independently trying to publicise his predicament and get a proper investigation. And so he's been on my show a couple of times talking about that. I'm hoping to get an independent witness to the whole thing on my show again very soon. So we'll have
someone else
talking about it.
And as we come closer and closer to the close of the show for your part anyway, Ben, weirdest place in Britain? Off the top of your head, what would you say?
Probably Oxford, you know. Or I'm just boasting because I'm biased. I don't know. Okay. There's so many weird things. There's so many weird things about Oxford, you know.
I heard about the Mount Jack Deer because I did a journalism course at Cough Uni, and we had one of our tutors was Marcos, who works with BBC at Oxford, and he told us all about the Mount Jack Deers, which are these tiny little deers that you have running around the streets. Is that still the case?
Yeah, they're really cute little things. I mean, they're very small. They're about the size of your average dog. I mean, they're really small deers, and they do sometimes run around the street at night. I mean, they're mostly during the day. You'll find them in green spaces like parks. There was one in a cemetery, which they managed to tranquilize it and take it out of the city. But yeah, they're lovely little things. I've seen a few of them.
Yeah. So anybody who's looking for mysteries and excitement are recommended to come to Oxford, and they'll find it in spades, eh, Ben?
Oh, definitely, yeah. There's all this. I've done a couple of videos all about the place where I live, and yeah, it's the Illuminati training centre of the world, and yeah, definitely a place to investigate.
Is it a big ley line place then?
Yeah, there's a guy called Ellis Taylor, who's a local man, who has he's doused the whole area with tracing the ley lines backwards and forwards. Oxford is kind of on the centre line of the country, and he's really gone into some detail about the strange things that happen here, that have been going on here. It's a river confluence. He goes into it on his detail on his website and in his books.
So it's a River Ox, isn't it, that runs through it?
It's two rivers, actually. It's the River Thames, which we call the Isis, and there's the River Cherwell, which is a large river that flows down from the north from Warwickshire.
The Isis?
It's interesting that, isn't it? We give it a name after an Egyptian goddess.
Yeah, because there's Magdalene College, isn't there?
Yeah.
At Oxford, which is spelt Magdalene College, but if you're posh, you call it Magdalene. So there's this big thing to do with Mary, mother of Jesus, around that part of the country, which I've always found interesting. But isn't there a ley line, the Mary line?
There's the Michael and Mary line, which goes, I don't know exactly where that goes. Ellis knows about these sorts of things. But on subject of the Magdalene, Mary Magdalene is said to be the wife of Jesus. Now, Jesus actually, I believe, had a wife and children.
Oh, it sounds like we're coming up to the top of the hour. Well, it's been great having you on, Ben. I'd love to have you on again. Honestly, we could talk for hours, but thank you for giving the listeners some interesting insights into what's been going on in Britain. We'll have you on again. Thanks very much, Ben.
Hi, you're very welcome. Thanks for having me on, Jana. Good night.
All right. Good night, Ben. You take care.
You too.
Listen to Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. We'll be right back after this message.
Many years from now, would you be willing to trade all the days from this day to that for one chance, just one chance, to come back here and tell our enemies that they may take our lives, but they'll never take
the future is uncertain. I know this. Death is inevitable. I know this. But one thing is certain. As free men, it is our right to live unencumbered and in peace. And those times are quickly drawing to an end. And in these times, peace is certainly an illusion. And as the chains grow tighter, our ability to slip those chains increase incrementally with every passing moment. Inaction is no longer an option. It's time to raise our voices like a cacophony of thunder and lightning and tell the masters no more. And this is Nighthawk, and I say, for myself, no more. Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, because the freedom is slipping away.
be evasive.
But that doesn't mean that they're telling the truth as opposed to fiction.
And Genesis chapter 6, verse 4, and there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came and unto the daughters of men, indicating that there were giants before the Nephilim.
And sons of God plural. They weren't talking about Jesus coming down.
No, that's right. Yeah.
I'm Steve Crawford, host of Factor Theory Live. Join me every Sunday night from 10 p.m. till midnight Eastern Standard Time on Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. Check it out.
I want to thank everybody for listening to Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com, the one place where information never sleeps. Revolution Radio!
Alright, let's show them what we got here.
Hi, Karl Marx here. I am all seriousness today, my friends. There is this show you must not listen to. The ultimate remedy with this guy, LB. This guy has figured me out. I hear it on Tuesday, and he is telling the truth. I mean lies. Stay away from this guy. Where's my good hairbrush? Anybody seen Mama?
Want to learn more about the Marxist agenda and other important stuff? Listen to The Ultimate Remedy with L.B. Bork, Tuesdays, 6 p.m. Eastern, right here on Revolution Radio.
All right, thanks for listening while we take that short break here at Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. And yeah, we're going to get back to your host.
Hiya, welcome back to the show, and that was really good, Jana, the interview there with Ben.
I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yeah, I heard it all. I decided to just clean off and have all...
Oh, are you back?
Oh, God, yeah, I haven't had a chance to. I am just so exhausted. It's so nice to bathe, isn't it, and... You know how to quick.
Oh, you're dropping.
I know, it's the microphone.
Oh dear.
Yeah, had a quick bathe. Feel better.
Good.
Yeah, I noticed you were covering, child sexual abuse, and I do try and stay away from it. I did, do a book on it, and Searching for Daddy, my own sexual abuse, and was quite drained after it, and. It's quite difficult, so I find it hard to talk about. But it was interesting you were saying about Darren G. I saw him, and that he had to endure that. That's really awful.
Yeah. Well, it was in the context of how things are going to develop in the future, and this seems to be a part of it. It seems to be unavoidable, but thank God there are whistleblowers like Andrew Guy. And, Darren G, for all his, crimes, whatever, he has spoken out. And it's like a puzzle that's being pieced together. Mm. Whereas before, people just couldn't speak out. They just weren't allowed to speak out for various different reasons. So, I appreciate it's very uncomfortable for you.
Yeah, it's not. It's not great, but, looking back at my time in care, I was just talking to my son about it today. There was a boy in our care home, and with social workers raped him, and he was like, I think 14 or something like that. And, they didn't tend to go near the girls. I mean, I was sexually abused by my adoptive father, and so... I was given to that family by the Roman Catholic Church because I was dumped with them. My mother was 13 and dumped me off there. And so I was adopted by this family that was really well connected to the Roman Catholic Church. And their sister was sister was a nun with the Daughters of St. Paul. And, you know, I was handed to them, and he was a paedophile. He's a gold-plated paedophile. And, you know, sexual abuse started straight away. And, you know, I sort of split and didn't have my whole ego. And then, you know, what my son didn't understand was, you know, oh, why do people make such a big deal out of that kind of thing? They think, you know, it's the worst evil that ever was. And, you know, because I guess some people find it hard to realize it's not just somebody going tickle, wickle, wickle to your privates and, oh, don't touch my no-no and that's it. It's it doesn't go away. So it, like, stays with you. And I don't know why that is, but it's like it kind of blocks out your soul in some kind of way. And it makes you, I don't know what, it's just really strange the effect it has. And, you know, having experienced it myself and having, you know, as you know, I went to interview Ian Brady and wanted to find out specifically why. I mean, my father was very good looking and young and, you know, turned heads of women. And I always wondered, why do men that are good looking do that? You know, surely it's for men that can't get women, so, oh, let's grab a child that's passing, you know, for something, you know. But it's like, no, these men actually, you know, sometimes quite pretty men actually prefer little girls or little boys. And I wanted to find out, you know, because, you know, you can't, and people say, oh, you know, I couldn't face them all as murderers. Well, I would like to be like that, where, oh, couldn't face it. But if you've got it like your father's doing it, you don't get the choice of walking away and forgetting about it. You've got to have a relationship with someone like that. And you've got to, it's weird because you've got to carry on having the relationship with it. And then if nobody believes you, which happened in my case, I didn't speak out about it. And I spoke out about it later. And, you know, the cousins and everybody said I was a liar and, you know, oh, Tommy's lovely and, you know, and all the neighbours loved him and I was left.
You hear that so many times.
It's horrible because not only have they blotted out your soul in some kind of way that you never really get over it because you can't enjoy sex. I mean, how can you possibly enjoy sex? You know, you've seen it when you were a kid and you'd see this big smelly thing coming towards you that you have to do things with. And then when you're older, you see another one, you know, it's got the same smell. You just, how are you supposed to, like, enjoy it? You don't, yeah. You know, I'm not gay either. I don't want to see a woman's bits. And it just totally screws you. And sex is a, you know, the normal thing. It's supposed to give enjoyment. You're supposed to, there are parts of your identity that are tied up with it. And, you know, you don't form that. You don't form a proper identity. And, you know, I spent my life studying Brady, then Bianchi and other, you know, other rapists, actually, you know, rapists. I wanted to know why they did it, you know. And I was almost searching for what is it inside them, you know, is it it's something demonic that comes in them, you know, because everyone thought my father was lovely, you know, always really nice. And I suppose he did have a side that I loved, you know, but also he was a predator, you know, and I only saw that. And he did, you know, it was there for other people to see. I remember at parties we used to go to, he used to, you know, go up to the little girls and go, like that, and, you know, stroke his hand down their hair, like, really slowly, you know. I mean, it was there.
Biden-y.
What?
A bit Biden-y. A bit Joe Biden.
Oh, really? Has he done that?
Oh, yeah, he's famous for it. You know, sniffing kids and stroking their hair and, like, touching them. He does it like in front of loads of people. There's just like loads of footage of him standing with loads of people at an event, and he's like, some people have pulled the kids away from him.
Yeah, but nobody seemed to notice, you know, my father doing it. And then after he'd finished and I came to puberty, they didn't want me there. And it was like really weird. It was like my father was sort of like scared at that point when I sort of turned into a woman. And my mother was, I suppose envious or something. So even though I kind of squashed it all down and became a skinhead and shaved my head off so I looked like a man, and talk like one as well, you know, talk like that, change my whole accent and whole being just to make them happy. And they put me into care, just ooh, too much trouble. I was absolutely terrified of them, so it couldn't have been too much trouble. And off I went into care, and there I found in care that the social workers, I mean, mine, you know, the paedophile was connected to the Catholic Church, but went into care, and the men in there were after the boys. And it was quite interesting because we girls, even though we were shaved head girls and rough as hell, we used to try and seduce them. So when the social workers would come, we would, you know, look at each other. And if they were good looking, we would sit on their knees and, you know, try and sort of seduce them. They weren't interested in us at all. They really targeted the boys. And, you know, it was horrible to see because these young boys, they weren't gay. And yeah, it happened to one boy, and he was raped, and he started to say, I think I'm gay, I think I enjoyed it, because it screws with their heads, and then they think, oh, I enjoyed it, because, you know, when you're sexually abused as a child, there is part of you that enjoys it. You know, there's part of me that's tied to my father. It, you know, when I have had sex with a man and being able to, it's only been with a man who's really, really, really like my father. And, you know, in looks and, you know, the sort of, you know, strong blue eyes and sort of, you know, that builder's laborer type. And because, you know, he owned me, he imprinted me, he owned me. So, you know, daddy's girl and that's it. And you never really break it. And what happens to these boys, I mean, they're often virgins and, you know, they get imprinted with that and they never go back. Often they never go back to, you know, what their sexuality would have been because it's been blotted out by. So it's like a really massive trauma to the soul. I mean, it's almost like murder. I think it's actually soul murder because the whole personality gets shattered into altars. And Mark became suicidal, and I was watching that thing. I don't know if you see, I know you haven't got Netflix, but there's a thing called The Fall with Gillian Anderson.
Okay.
It's really good. And that was about a serial killer, and he'd based it on Bianchi, although he hasn't said that in reports, but he's based it on Kenneth Bianchi, the Hillside Strangler. And, you know, came to the end of it, series three, and they revealed that he'd been in this one of these Northern Ireland boys' homes, King Cora and all those boys' homes where they'd been raped by the paedophile priests. And that is why he became a serial killer. And it was really good the way they, you know, picked apart his mind and what it does to you, that kind of, you know, that kind of rape by someone older. You know, it's just, it's horrific. It's not just people say it and they don't really grasp the whole picture of it. It's not just,
I think you're right. I mean, I've met quite a lot of people through work and stuff that this has happened to, and some of them they've ended up being capable of doing some really terrible things to other people, not sexually, but otherwise.
I think it causes a massive anger, because I think deep down in your psyche, you know that you've had your soul, your very identity, your very being overturned, almost like sort of punked over or something, and it's obliterated. It somehow, some way, that adult doing that to a child, it does that. I would like to know how and why it does that, but it's like a spiritual violation. They seem to be able to taint their very spirit, and I don't know how or why that works. I don't know if you've got some insight into that, about how or why that happens.
No, not really. I haven't. But from what other people say, the fact that it's part of trauma-based mind control tells you a lot, that it can be used to mould somebody into whatever purpose you need them to be. And it can make people capable of, like I said, of quite horrendous things. So it's like removing, there's not only an element of being able to mould somebody, but also an element of removing their humanity, because what they've had to them, done to them, is basically inhuman. So, I mean, there's all kinds of tangents we could go off in about this. There's a demonic, there's a Draco, there's so many different explanations.
That's a good point. I think somebody, what's that noise? Somebody spoke to me about that, actually. Demonic activity, that's right. Demonic activity, that the during that sexual abuse of a child, a demon will appear, because it's demonic, because the very act itself, and the demon parasiting in the adult doing it, violating the innocence and purity of the child. The demon then feeds, and then the demon presumably enters into the child. Or it might just be that the child feels that demon.
Yeah.
It might be like, I did feel that from my father, and I think when I went to interview Brady, and certainly with Bianchi, who had an alter that did the raping, Steve, and I wanted to meet Steve. You know, I sat there with Bianchi and I thought, where's Steve? You know, I've traveled for 24 hours on a plane and I'm sitting here with some guy. Where's Steve that did all the raping, one after another and after another? And it actually wasn't there. But then for a fraction of a second, I had that presence of that that sort of other being. And it was odd, because it almost stopped me in this lifelong search of looking for that. And then I came face to face with it and I was frozen. And I thought, I don't want to look anymore. Yeah, I've seen it and it scared me. And and it was like not human. It wasn't human. And I suppose perhaps being a witness of that, like in the serial killer in The Fall, perhaps, you know, he became very otherworldly and very aware, oh, death this, death that. And I think serial killers do, and people find them like massively fascinating, because they've seen over into the abyss, and they've seen this, like, you know, this other creature. So it makes them different from your average, like, you know, person that's not really, I mean, now, like, there's us, which we're woken up and we're aware of that, but your average sheep like person, they don't know anything about that kind of thing, and they're just concerned with breakfast, dinner, tea, watch Coronation Street, go to bed. So people that have experienced that other dimension in that rape, they feel completely locked outside of that paradigm of normality.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you look at sex as an energy, and within mad, sex is a very powerful tool for manifesting what you want to happen, actually the act of having sex. So the very negative, twisted element of sex, because there's like tantric sex, isn't there, which is like really spiritual sex. So there's like different aspects to sex, isn't there? It can be, and it's procreation, it's creation of life. So then you've got the other side of it. It's used for nefarious purposes. So it's like the use of a very, very negative energy to shatter something. If you look at what's going on now, like I don't know why, but they don't seem to be on as much now. Maybe YouTube have banned them or something, and Facebook as well. But there's all these like vigilante paedophile hunter gangs in the UK. And they have somebody who acts as a decoy, and then they arrange to go and meet and it's always a man, who thinks they're meeting a 12-year-old girl, blah, blah, blah. And they confront them and they call the police and they don't hurt them and everything, but they, like, read out some of the things that they've said to them over the internet and they try and deny it. And some of them start crying and some of them are Mr. Average. A lot of them seem to be young men with learning difficulties. Some of them are married and the wives stick by them. But the one joining element of all of them is it's all through the internet. And this is why I've just got, it just keeps coming back to the same thing. I'm pretty sure demonic is something to do with AI. And the internet is the perfect way of, like, distributing this energy, isn't it? I mean, there's always been pornography in whatever form. That's always seems to have existed. But, like, and I think kiddie porn has existed for a lot longer than people probably.
Probably not before photographs and film and all that.
Who knows? But
They had orgies, and that is similar.
I mean, probably. The Greeks were into it, weren't they? Because they used to put things on the sides of vases, like having sex with children, young boys. Yeah. Having sex with boys, and the Romans as well, having sex with boys, young boys, like you were saying about the social workers, young boys. But this seems to be a really efficient way of... But what is going on with these men? Have all these men en masse? There seems to be so many of them. This is what I can't get my head around. It is like a virus that's gone through the internet and entered into people's consciousness or their souls. And there's just so many of them. Just so many of them. This is a horrendous thing. And it just seems to be global. So what has happened there?
You mean there's more and more? I found it hard to, you know, meet other people that had been through it when I was younger. So it's interesting to know that, you know, it's getting worse and worse out there. And my father seemed to be, you know, the only one. But mind you, I did go to those groups. I found it hard to sit in them. You know, the groups where you sit around and other people are being abused by their fathers. And, you know, I remember one group we all sat there and there was about 10 of us. And we just all sat there crying. I mean, nobody said anything.
Well, it'll re-traumatise you, won't it? I mean, when you ask to repeat what's happened to you over and over again, it'll be traumatizing. Unless you're in control of it. But if somebody's demanding that, yeah, and it's meant to be good for you, you know.
Yeah, I always feel as well when I tell people, especially in a group like that, that they're thinking, oh, liar. No, he didn't. He was a really nice guy. You know, that goes around my head. And I look at them and I think, they're not believing me. Do you know? I feel like I have to do something.
But that's the path of least resistance, isn't it? It's easier for them not to believe you than it is to believe that. It's much harder for people to face up to. I mean, you look at all the children of famous people or famous families, you know, in entertainment media, and it's come out that the father was sexually abusive. How could they have come out with that at the height of their fame? It would have ruined everything. You know, from money, work, fame and all that. So there's lots of reasons why people put barriers up to not wanting to believe that somebody has done that. But, I mean, that's just classic for abuse across the board. Oh, he's so nice. Oh, he's this, oh, he's that.
It's annoying. And I remember being in primal therapy in America and there was a woman sharing about her abuse by her father and the guy in charge made me sit next to her. And as she was saying it all, I was crying and crying. And then when she'd finished, I was just exhausted, sat there. And one of the women in the group, the first one to speak, said, are you sure he did that? Are you sure you're not making it up? I can't believe it.
Oh, my God.
Good job it wasn't to me. I would have leapt on her. I would have not been able to control myself, which is why those kind of things are quite dangerous. You know, people sort of, you know, emotions are high. But the woman took it, you know, she goes, yeah, yes, it did happen. And
so she was calm. Well, kudos to her.
I wouldn't have been.
I would have found it hard. No, it's horrible. It's horrible being called a liar about abuse. Absolutely horrible. It's awful. It's bad enough something horrendous has happened to you in the first place. Then to be told that you're lying and making it up just adds to it, adds to your trauma.
Because there's no way of sort of proving it, is there? There's no way of sort of, I don't know, I still feel quite bitter. And then sometimes I feel jealous of people that have, you know, been sort of out there and people acknowledge that they've been abused because it's been someone famous or whatever. And I feel almost like envious. I feel, you know, my father should be on a big poster somewhere and everybody should drive past Guardian. There's that paedophile, you know? I feel like he's gotten away with it. Well, he's dead. And, you know, although
well,
I've named
him in a book... Has he, Christine? You've written a best-selling novel about it. Book about it.
Yeah.
You've exposed him.
I had to change his name.
Well, yeah, but, you know, we know, don't we? So he hasn't got away with it completely. The truth has been exposed about him. All right, he might have passed over, but the fact is, it's not... There's not the silence anymore. So... He's not won completely, not in any respect. But I mean, this is the problems with, like I was saying to Ben about people in positions of power. You know, the Merseyside police covering up all the pedos, the elite pedos, elite people in positions of power all this time, and they're still doing it. And the grooming gangs are carrying on.
I just don't know why they like. Young girls, you know, why don't they like women? I mean, women have got all those curves, don't they find that? I suppose it's fear of them. I mean, my father was, like, weak, and I guess it's like they think women are just going to sort of slap them down. Presumably, that's it.
Basic feminist theory is that men fear women. There is this fear of women, and that's why women have been, like, vilified and persecuted, apart from things like excuses like, in the Bible, you know, Eve was made subordinate to Adam and all the rest of it. But then his first wife was meant to be Lilith. He refused to be subordinate to him, but we don't learn about her. She has become a demoness. There's been this fear, I think, forever, really. So is it that? What goes on inside the mind of a paedophile? This is what, there must be people who know, why do they want to have sex with children? You know, it's bizarre.
I tried to, you know, I tried to find out, you know, by meeting them, by prodding them. And I was always looking for something otherworldly, something there. And it's all because I finally, after all these years of my entire, life, pushing at, you know, Brady first and then Bianchi. I finally found it with Bianchi when I was face to face with him, and it just terrified me. It was something, it wasn't human, and it was looking at me, and it followed me home. There it was, in my house. I felt something was watching me, and I started having these really horrible visions. I'd be like it was horrible. I'd be sitting opposite a friend, and all of a sudden I would see them like stretched on a cross and like looking at me, help me. It was like really, or I'd be sitting opposite.
So that sounds demonic. Yeah. Do you think it was demonic?
Oh man, yeah, it was definitely.
Well, the reason why I ask is because, like, you know, some people believe that anything to do with aliens is a manifestation of the demonic. So that potentially there's a distinction between that and other, well, maybe interdimensional beings or something like that. So
I don't know. I just know there was these. First of all, I was seeing in my mind's eye homosexual pornography. So I immediately thought, well, it must be Bianchi, because all these serial killers, they're always homosexual. They cover that up. That's all hidden. But
I didn't know that. Really,
yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah, yeah. When you get to know them, like, you know, Brady, you could have called him, you know, Susan or something, you know, completely. Or he did lunge on me and put his tongue down my throat. But again, it didn't feel like anything sexual. He was just doing that to sort of do it, maybe to prove something to himself, which was horrific. And
I can't even get my head around that. I never have been able to. Well, I think you've dropped. You're back.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, well, yeah, that was horrific. I'm still looking into suing Park Lane over that. And then, you know, with Bianchi, after I had that experience of, you know, closeness to Bianchi and came home and, Yeah, the vision started and they started that homosexual pornography. So I thought, this is something connected with him. And then I was seeing visions of men buried out like in the Middle East, like with just their heads sticking out above the sand and like screaming because the sun was burning them.
And in the Middle East?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like not in England, you know, somewhere like that, sort of sandy, hot, you know.
Okay, that's a clue. All right. Yeah, well, a lot of the demonic comes from the Middle East.
Does it?
The Goetia, the Babylonian demon. Yeah, they're from the Middle East. You know, ones like, what's that one that Thomas Sheridan goes on about and was in The Exorcist, beginning with P? That's a desert one. Yeah, a lot of them are from deserts. God, I can't remember the name of it. It'll come to me. But a lot of them are from... Sorry.
Why are they from deserts?
I don't know. But a lot of them come out of Babylon, and a lot of them are out of the Middle East. So the desert thing, that's ringing alarm bells. That's making me think, hang on a minute, I'll try and... Oh, Pizazu. Pizazu, I think, is the one that Thomas Sheridan goes on about.
What was he saying about it?
Well, it was right at the beginning of The Exorcist when there's a priest in the desert and he finds, like, this little statuette in the sand, and it's a statuette of Pizazu, and that's the demon that is meant to possess Regan.
How did it get to Regan?
I can't remember. I only saw it once, and that was when such a long time ago, I can't bloody remember. But it's got specific, they all govern specific things, don't they? You know, one of them is a slug infestation. If you get a slug infestation in your house, it's meant to be to do with Pizazu. But I mean, there's a few of them.
It was quite interesting. I had that, and that went on for a long, long time. And yeah, it was the desert, and there were men buried in the desert. They weren't English; they were like Middle Eastern. Yeah, and they were, and I do believe that goes on out there, that sort of torture. And of course, they had no water, and it was horrific actually to think about it. And then. Well, it was mainly that, yeah. And then I rang that Chris Berry D, who had also met Bianchi, I spent 8 hours with him. Then I went back to stay in the hotel, then had another 8 hours with him. And Chris Berry D had only met him for 5 minutes, but he had experienced the same thing. Because I said, did you notice anything spooky when you were dealing with him? I thought, I won't lead him. And he goes, he can get inside your head. And he can look round your head and it feels like something inhuman going round your head. And I'm like, thanks very much. You might have told me. And he said, I did tell you. But yeah, it was something not human. So he said to me that he got so sick, he had to go to the church. So I thought, okay, well, I'll do that because I knew a Catholic church where I used to grow up. So I went there and spoke to Father Phil and said to him, look, I've visited this serial killer and this is happening. I'm getting visions and these horrible thoughts. But it was mainly the visions. And he gave me something to read out of the Bible and he blessed me. He gave me some holy water and I... did that and it went
right. So who gave you the holy water?
The priest, Catholic.
Right.
It went. It worked. I mean, they went. I mean, it was happening. You know, it was. I mean, it went on. You know, for a couple of weeks, and I thought, yeah, this is scaring the shit out of me. Because how long is this going to go on? And it would happen like spontaneously. You'd be walking somewhere, you know, down the street normally, and it would pop into your head. And I'm not talking lightly. It would really, like, be really, really strong. It was terrifying.
It sounds horrible. I mean, it sounds like it knew you were looking at it, and it decided, like, who are you looking at me, puny human? I'm going to make you suffer. But then nothing can be Jesus, and that's the highest power. So
that's interesting. So So
it wanted to have a look at you because it knew that you were looking for it by the sound of it. Because they can see everything, can't they? They're outside of space and time. That's why when people get possessed, they know things about people, like their deepest, darkest secrets kind of thing, and they blurt them out. And then they can say, they see in the past and the future, they come out with things, information. And that's why sometimes people who are involved in magic or whatever, they want a demon to come into them so they have the knowledge that the demon possesses and the powers.
And what knowledge would that be?
The being outside of space and time and being able to see what's going to happen. And also whatever attributes that particular demon possesses that they can manifest while they're in their, you know, the human body. And then they have to get them out of the body again. So, I mean, I'm no expert. This is just what things I've just picked up through watching people like Thomas Sheridan and things like that. But just on an intuition thing, that sounds like what happened to me is it clocked you, it knew you were looking for it, and it clocked you, and it thought, and it, to them, you're an ant. And they're thinking, well, ant, don't bother me. Here, have a load of this. See what you think of this, because this is what I dish out, so you can have some of this if you've been looking for me. Well, thank God you got the priest to get rid of it. Yeah, you must be a very strong woman to have tolerated all that, because some people, it would just, you know, they just would have gone loop-de-loop. Absolutely.
Yeah, God, thinking about that, that's awful. But I wonder, did my father have that? It did just scare me, and I thought, oh, I'm not going to be interested in that again. So I'm not really searching anymore. I feel like I've seen it and found it, and, you know, I do think my father had something like that, and it's weird. I think I tasted it as a child and then went looking for it, and it's
well, you
not
wanted
like
answers.
A sort of... what
you wanted answers,
yeah
to the source of the emotional pain in your life, so, and that's what has driven you all this time, and it's driven you to, you know, travel across the world to confront it, and you did.
I mean, what do you think? I mean, that those visions that I had, was that actually it? Was that sort of, I mean, or was that where it was hanging out? Or what? What was I seeing?
It was just horrification, wasn't it? It was just messing with you. It was just conjuring up the most horrible things it could conjure up and putting it in your mind. Yeah. It was messing with you, basically. So, by the sound of it, anyway.
I wondered, was it Bianchi himself? But looking back, I don't think it was. I just think it's something that sits in him, you know?
Yeah, I think that. From what you've described, I don't think it's him. I think it's something that sits in him.
And people always find these serial killers fascinating, like that TV show, you know, the killer was made out to be so fascinating, but really, you know, it's what's in them. I wish people would kind of see that these people, they're not interesting, they're not, I mean, they're very, you know, they're very weak, and they're always hosting, they've always got a slippery hold on their body because of their childhood sexual abuse, and that is what, you know, nobody seems to really like question it, or they just kind of accept it and they don't question it.
Well, people can't, but because people don't make that leap, do they? We can make that leap because of our lives and our experiences, but people are looking at things from this really 3D place, and there has to be a scientific explanation. There has to be something in a book like the DM. I always said DMZ, which is bloody, what is it, demilitarized zone. The one that's in America that has all these psychiatric disorders in it. Mm. It has to be an empirical explanation for something that is completely anti-empirical. Mm. And anything outside of that doesn't exist. Well, we know that's bullshit. So that's why you'll get that.
Carry on.
Well, I was going to say, if that's the case, then how come you hear reports of when these men, and more often not they are men, are in prison, why do you get reports of guards saying that they see them levitate off the beds and they hear them talking in languages that don't exist anymore? What's happening there? Because of what they've got inside them. So, you know, and like I said, I think that film that I've referred to in the past about the police officer that calls in a priest to help him with a soldier that's possessed by a djinn. I think it's called Deliver Us From Evil.
Oh, right, I'll check that.
Yeah. So, I mean, that was, like I said, through the trauma of war, because war is like huge energy and huge trauma. And so they're getting in.
They do tend to make these films like horror, and they have so much gore that you can't really look at it and examine it.
Is it on Netflix? Yeah, it was. Yeah, I don't know if it's still on. The cop, he was a New York detective. He had to investigate some very strange murders. He ended up investigating this. I think he was a Marine or a soldier that had been in Afghanistan. He'd come back, he'd started acting really strangely. All right, it's a film, so there'll be bits of it that's, you know, padded out and exaggerated. But anyway, he ended up linking up with the priest, and they ended up sort of like realising they were dealing with the demonic. And in the film, they sort of like get it out of him in the end. And it's meant to be the cop ends up training to be a priest and gets ordained. So, but
I suppose unfulfilling about the rather brilliant, you know, what was it called, The Fall on Netflix with Gillian Anderson? At the end, the guy, Jamie Dornan, the serial killer, which was based on Bianchi, hanged himself. So, and then it sort of went close up to Gillian Anderson, who was a cop in her house. And I thought, almost like a punch in the gut, you know, because you've been through this whole journey of seeing this guy do it. You'd found out, you know, what made him screwed up was the sexual abuse in the King Cora kids home. But there was no answers. And so it was almost like a kind of a story of reading a novel, thinking, oh, it's going to get to the good bit at the end where you sort of have this learning, you've learned something and you go away a bigger, better person. But there was nothing. It just ended almost like it had been cauterized, and I felt like shortchanged as hell. And then, of course, I've done, you know, I did Channel 4 with that Helen Hill.
Can you repeat that? Because you dropped, you did Channel 4 with Helen.
Helen Hill, about Brady. It was a documentary.
Okay.
And I was the only one on there that had met him. Well, Fred Harrison met him, I think, once, you know, in the Scrubs, and he was, you know, very sick. He didn't say much. I had met him, you know, three times and sat with him for hour upon end, so knew far more. And he, soon as she filmed me, and she filmed me a lot up at the studios, and I started talking about evil and my experience of Bianchi, and she went, hang on, you know, that's going too woo-woo. I don't want to go there. And then when it came out, there was nothing. You know, they'd cut me, and, you know, it was making out he was like a bank robber. And then they said, oh, bank robbers were scared of him. And they made out like he was like John McVicar, and it was offensive, actually. It was massively offensive. No inclination to look for the truth, and no inclination. And you get these cheesy crime writers that I don't particularly like. You know, some of them are really aggressive as well, you know, trolling other people, etc., etc. And they don't know anything. You know, they haven't even studied psychology.
It's quite exploitative, really, isn't it?
Yeah, and then, you know, studying psychology, that won't get you anywhere, because psychology doesn't know anything. It's that only goes so far. Even psychology that heals us, you know, they don't know much about that either. So it's psychology is a kind of learning thing. And they have to look at the spiritual angle, and nobody ever does look at the spiritual angle.
They won't. They won't, because it's taboo, isn't it? It's got taboo. A massive taboo.
And I think they want, I don't know, do they want to sort of say, oh, we've got evil locked in a cell, or they like the sexy thing of the, you know, the sort of Silence of the Lambs, and aren't they really dark, and, you know, they're really evil. Well, they're not. They're just shells, really. They're shells, and they're like quite, you know. Yeah, they're puppets, and they're quite delicate little puppets as well, you know. And they had as well what he did have in that thing. He had the serial killer beating up the, you know, beating up men. And they don't normally beat up men. I suppose Brady, no, that was a teenager. But, you know, they normally stay away from men, because men, you know, are roughy-toughy, and they sort of target weakness. You know, they are usually really, really weak individuals.
Yeah, it's interesting that you said that a few times about Brady and Bianchi.
But they try and make out not, you know, they try and make out not in these documentaries, like men were scared of him. I can honestly say, hand on heart, that, you know, they wouldn't have been scared of him. Why would they? No, they wouldn't. It's just, it's insulting as well to men that have been in prison.
It's funny, isn't it, how there's this industry around crime and criminals.
There is an industry around it. There is, and they don't want the truth either.
Oh,
you know,
no.
They don't want that. I mean, my book, In for the Kill, I literally, you know, met Brady, met Bianchi, and, you know, did a lot of really sort of in, I mean, I worked very hard on Bianchi, because to start with, he's very quick to reject. And I got, you know, I would spend a lot of time writing, and then I would get, you know, I don't want to deal with you anymore. I don't want to deal with you anymore. And it would be like banging my head against the wall. And I would be in tears, literally, and try again. And I took up smoking. I would sit at the laptop. I would be smoking. I would type a letter. I would read it over and think, no, that's not the right note. It's not going to work. And then do it all over again. I was massive amount of work went into it. You know, massive amount of work went into the book. And, you know, I wrote about the experience in there and thought that it would be valuable, you know, even valuable. And no, the book flopped. It didn't make me, after 3 years of studying him every single day and then going over there, which was commissioned by The Guardian, and, you know, sitting with him for 2 days, nothing, didn't get anything out of it. Took me a year to edit the book with Transworld, the publisher, and it just went nosedive straight down, you know. And they get things where they make up stuff and, oh, it's, you know, really successful. And it wasn't right. You know, I'd even managed to get Bianchi's poetry, and there was stuff where he talked about his winter shattered mind, and, you know, how he relives it over and over again, his winter shattered mind. And the poetry was fascinating, and I put that in there, and it's not really right. And okay, yeah, I'm bitter because, you know, I'd worked so hard and didn't get a payday. I mean, literally, I didn't get anything, absolutely nothing, nil, not even a pound. And I ended up, they said, a legal bill, because it took £6,000 to legal it, because I'd talked about the phone hacking. So it was like a minus, and I haven't paid them off. And the book, you know, didn't sell. And it makes me, you know, resentful. But not only resentful, is that they don't want to know. And maybe it's these creatures that are controlling things, and probably controlling things right now, that they do stay behind the scenes. And maybe it's the same creatures that the elite are dealing with. And maybe, you know, one or two of them do go and feed or something. Or maybe they're feeding them somewhere. I don't know. It's all a bit...
Sounds like it, doesn't it? Something like that's going on. I mean, the book's still out there, though, isn't it?
Oh, nobody's read it. It got trolled heavily by a certain crime writer and her little gang. And that put me into a depression, because it was really nasty and personal. You know, people, these truth women talk about, I'm being trolled. You know, if they really want to experience what I did for 3 years, it was horrific, and it got me down, you know, very, very much. And I had to use the Eric Coetting to help me. He used black magic on the person that was targeting me, and that was the only way, through a binding, that literally I could get this piece of shit off my back.
Fire with fire.
Yeah, well, that was how heavy it was, you know, and that was the dark side. And thinking about that, why did the dark side not want that to rise, you know? It felt like it was just taken up and just smashed on the floor. You know, we're publishing it, but not really. We're sort of like hidden. Do you know what I mean? I knew a lot about the News of the World, and that was the guy, the publisher sat on it for a year. And during that time, the News of the World closed, meaning that everything in it that was like, you know, interesting just died because all of a sudden, oh, the paper's closed. Why would anybody be interested in what's going on in the newspaper? And all that stuff about John Boyle just, you know, covered over. So it was like they brought it to kill it. You know, that happens sometimes.
You told me about that. Shame you couldn't have self-published it.
Yeah, I probably should have, looking back. I mean, you know, just for it to hit the deck after all that work and all that research, you know, literally going there. And even Chris Berry D, he said, wow, he said, you know, you went there and you did it. And it was hard, you know, I was scared. And I remember the day before I went to see Bianchi, I felt sick. I thought, should I have a drink? And I took a mouthful of wine and it was the middle of the day and I just spat it out again. I just felt like this, I can't do this. And, you know, when I went in there, this other woman was talking about how someone got a knife the other day and stabbed someone. And I thought, oh, don't tell me, don't tell me. I am 2 minutes of walking out of here because I was terrified, you know, absolutely terrified. And I pushed myself and you think, well, what the hell was it for? I might as well just stayed at home and watched an episode of Coronation Street.
Chris Berry Day is going to be on Sean Atwood soon.
No.
Hmm.
You're kidding?
No, I saw it the other day. He's going to be on Sean Atwood.
Oh, okay. Well, he's a friend of mine, actually. I did ask him to come on here. I'll give him an email after that. It's weird. I spoke to him today and thought, well, shall I ask Chris to come on? I mean, I did speak to him a while ago and say you should do radio. Oh, so Sean has got him. Isn't he supposed to be the bad guy or something? So that's interesting. Is he just going to kill
what,
the whole...
Sean Atwood? Oh, my God. How long have you got? There ain't enough long of the show to go into it all.
That pisses me off because he was supposed to come and speak to me. And, you know, what better to expose the story I've just told you and the story that he was destroyed and had to run to the church? Who better to talk about it than me and him, because we went through it together? And now I suppose if he's going to go on there, it will just be there won't be any talk of I can bet 50 quid there will be no talk of the demonic realm.
I don't know, because he has is it Wilfred Wu, the Chinese guy that deals with the demonic? He does have people on his show that, I mean, he's had what's his face, the cop guy that is a Christian, evangelical Christian. Right. He was like going after pedos. I can't remember what he's called. The one that people slag off. Anyway, he does have people like that on his show that talks about the demonic. So he doesn't shy away from that area. He lets people talk.
It'd be interesting, you know, what Chris will say to him, you know, and whether they do talk about Bianchi. Bianchi's pretty special, you know.
Why is he special then compared to the other serial killers?
Because he's still got it in him. You know, the others, I don't think they're still... I mean, Brady certainly had long left, even though he's certainly got a dirty, dirty spirituality. You know, he's holding all his memories. So he's filthy, but he's not hosting. Whereas Bianchi is still hosting. And,
so he's active.
Yeah. And Chris picked that up, you know. But as I say, he was 5 minutes with him. I was like, you know, 8 hours on two separate days. So...
We should ask Bill Bean to come on. See if Bill Bean will come on and talk about all this kind of thing.
Oh, sorry, I don't know who that is.
He's the exorcist that is on... oh, God, why do I always have memory blanks when I'm on the show? He's on tonight, actually, on the Scottish Guys show, that Freaky Friday and all that.
Oh, you have to send me a link, because I, you know, these creatures, the, you know, I think they're behind what's going on right now. You know, the lockdown, this so-called, you know, I mean, I'm sure there is something going around, you know, that's infecting all of us. But I think, you know, this is something really creepy going on. I really do. And I think these beings, whatever they are, they're more powerful than us, obviously. They're more intelligent than us. They're intradimensional. And I think as well as like feeding and what in like the sort of rape and feeding off the fear at that certain time. And, you know, I think they've taken over. I think they're hosting the elite. And I think they want to finish us off. They want to crush us. And I think they want to make this place a lower frequency, a place of pure misery and no joy.
Oh, God knows. I don't know. What was it we were on about?
What does this Bill gentleman say?
Well, he's a Christian and he goes around and like a lot of people calling him, and he goes around and gets things out of people and out of the houses. He has a lot to say, really.
Well, I've done that before. You know, when people, when I give them psychic readings, a lot of them have got stuff in their chakras, like the chap I, you know, was doing the other day. He had an entity in his sacral chakra. And then when I cast it out of him the next day, it was around me. And, you know, I had that massive low frequency around me. And the only way I got rid of it was the vetiver oil, which is massively powerful. So me and him might have, you know, we can trade stories.
I think you'd be an interesting person to get on, and you could discuss your experiences as well with, you know, Brazy and Bianchi and get his take on it, because I think when he was a child, the reason why he came into all this is when he was a child there was a lot of demonic activity in the house as he was growing up, and then I think he sort of did various jobs as an adult and then ended up going and becoming religious and just doing this kind of thing.
So he's a priest? Is he a priest?
No, he's not a priest. No.
Oh, right.
He's an exorcist. He calls himself an exorcist, but he's not a member of the Catholic Church. He's a...
It's weird that the priests, they do have a power, and the holy water has a power. And it's odd because, you know, there's paedophiles in the Roman Catholic Church, but also the Catholics do have this power against them.
Maybe I can't work the Catholic Church out.
The holy water, I've got some beside me. I use it every day.
Where do you get it from? Because I could do some of that. Where'd you get it from?
Well, I could probably send you some. It's the nearest Catholic church.
Okay.
But yeah, I get some. I put it on my crown chakra, and then I rub it into my hands, and I like clean my aura with it. And it does. It keeps a lot of attacks off. I mean, I've now got an entity. I use an entity which is somebody that I knew in a past life, and I have him as protection. So I question with him every day, you know, is someone attacking me? Is someone attacking my chakras? And I can protect that way. But also, you know, it's a very good cleansing thing, holy water. Who knows why? Oh, we're
interesting. Oh, it sounds like we're over. Oh, yeah. Well, thank you very much for listening, everybody, and good night and take care. Thanks, Christine.
Thanks for listening, and that was just a really good interview earlier. Thanks for listening, everybody, and thank you to Jana. See you next week. Thank you for listening up to the radio. On to the next episode.
Thank you for listening to Revolution.